to experiment with your ideas. And if you can experiment with your ideas, it will trigger ideas in others. And then those ideas will progress, and questions will be asked, and you will develop your own learning that you want to go away and do. But you'll also develop a group learning that you want to go away and do. So what I'd like to do, Tutor has lots of pretty colours. This is my tool. So every time anybody says anything, it has to go up on the wall. Otherwise it's just into the air. And if it's up on the board, it means that each of us can collectively see what's happening. Sometimes things go very fast, lots of ideas come up. One person doesn't have to be up at the board, you could all be up at the board putting things up if that's the case. So there's no right, there's no wrong in how we do it. It's about you, how you feel it's going to work best. So you're the control panel, and I'm your guide. I will guide you to where the curriculum has told us we need to get you to. So these are the objectives that I have, and I will guide you to where that is. So there's no risk of you missing out on what the curriculum and the school wants you to do. But you might do more, and by doing more means it encourages you to. What that means is that it sparked an idea in your mind, and you're starting to be a pretty good thinker and a problem solver in areas that you didn't know that you were. So shall we start? Now I sit down. Does anybody want to do that? And you can choose your colour. You can choose your colour. Just return the title. So what can we see on the screen at the moment? What bits of information? You'll find people will look at me.
Yes,
Thank you.
PBL process hasn't started. We've only got keywords. I know in your mind you're thinking, what is it? Hypothesis. Your all differential diagnosis that you've got. Hypothesis. So this is the brainstorm. What do you know about this sort of thing that it might be? Remember, you're not clinicians, you're not MDs at the moment. Think basic. So, you just said, that's really good. What is it? So please explain what it is. Physiological processes. You've written one there as an example is inflammation. It is a process. That'd be alright. And put a bracket around the ones that you say are infection. So what other words could go up on that diagram that will help you? Anybody jump up?
Yeah.
Please.
That may be active around this are the structure in this.
I'm trying to you to tell the group.
Yeah, every group can hear.
Yeah. So what does the group think of what's just been said?
That the patient may have infection of the tooth itself or of the tissue around it, maybe from the sinus or the nerve or
I think the career of him is the one of the pilot.
When you go on the
fungal disease can be developed recently.
That was a really good discussion. Can you recap? Can you just review what you've just said so that we can put that back up? It's a very good point that you made. So what was just said? Because it went into the air again. It needs to go up on the information now, it would just put an end to the discussion. And I want the discussion. I want everybody to feel free to, in my group here, to talk. So,
when you don't know the target.
Ví dụ như giờ nếu mà em mà không có biết cái mục tiêu của mình, cái gì em lại cho mục tiêu gì á, thì có thể là em là người thú thú về mô, em sẽ nói nhiều về mô răng quá trời luôn, quá trời sâu luôn. Rồi ví dụ như cái một bạn khác thú thú về nhiễm trùng, cái bạn đó cũng nói quá trời nhiễm trùng, vi trùng nào gây đó, thì cái BBM của mình nó không có thể nào mà thì nhóm này nói những cái chuyện nhóm kia đào sâu thì cái kia nên
mình có một cái khoảng thời gian để dành cho brainstorming.
Cái mục tiêu của cái case này đó, mục tiêu cái trường hợp này đó là để là cô cho mình là hôm qua cô giải thích cho mình là cái các bước đầu tiên là muốn mà tiếp cận bước đầu tiên khi mình là giảng dạy BBM là hôm qua các bước như thế này đang diễn ra như thế nào, chủ yếu là lấy thông tin sau đó để xây dựng cái kiến thức cho sinh viên để tiếp cận đang là ở lúc đó. Rồi trong quá trình đó thì đóng vai đó chúng ta là một đang cô nói hồi nãy cô nói là sinh viên chúng ta đang đóng vai là sinh viên đăng ký nhất, chúng ta hoàn toàn kiến thức về liên quan gần như là zero. Thì với vậy ví dụ như em là sinh viên đang ngồi em thấy em thích em hứng thú nói là em thích về mô hay là bạn này là
đó nãy giờ em thấy là mình đã đi quá xa luôn đến cái mục tiêu đó rồi.
Đúng rồi, cô chưa can thiệp vô, đang nói cái hiểu này nè, cô đang để cho tất cả các bạn sinh viên cho ý kiến và suy nghĩ gì cứ nói lên, còn cô là vai trò tiếp thơ lúc đó sẽ control thì cái bước đó là các học sao cô sẽ làm chuyện đó, còn đang ở trong giai đoạn là xây dựng kiến thức và cung cấp kiến thức, là ý là như vậy, cô học là như vậy.
Ý em muốn nói nếu mà mục tiêu mình như vậy thì mình đừng có đi quá sâu, em đã đi quá xa cái mục tiêu là sinh viên năm nhất, sinh viên năm nhất gì mà biết quá trời very adorable practice.
State the learning objectives.
I actually want to codify this point, Jill. This is my question yesterday, but I didn't have a chance to ask. Because I wonder, in a case like this, it can be a very broad discussion. And I wonder if it's deliberate that you don't state the learning objective up front. Because I feel that if you, whether PBL is designed this way, but it seems that if you have a learning objective up front, then it's easier to guide the discussion, easier for the student to focus where they should focus.
So this is,
I feel like this is enough already, and we could move on already, but we're sitting there with flounder on,
we're doing the PBL process at the moment, not necessarily the content that's up there. So what we're doing is I'm deliberately making it slow, so because we haven't got all of the points up on the board that need to be up there, because the next step is what other information do we need to have to differentiate between those different hypotheses that are up there. The reason why we have learning objectives after is because if you have them before, you will only go to those. Now, I've tutored in groups that have had learning objectives up front, and the tutor has a reverse role of trying to make them think widely, because a patient will come into you not with their learning objectives. They will not come in with their list of learning objectives. That's you as a clinician have to work out what is that problem. So what we're trying to mimic is the patient coming into you, and you have to work out what's going on, and you have to work out all the differentials at the beginning. So it's trying to embed in your brain that when you go out there, it's not going to be the list of learning objectives. And you have to have faith in the system, because your learning objectives are the curriculum. So at the end, if the student hasn't got all of them, then we will review as a group, why didn't we get them all? What could have we done better? And it refines the learning. So I think we should move on and we see how it pans out. Somebody who's questioning why that's been put up.
Yes.
So whoever said it needs to justify it and have evidence so far to justify that being there. But what evidence do we have for that to be there? I think you probably mean you want to know whether he's got any pre-existing condition, rather than a specific condition. You want to know whether he's got anything that's pre-existing. Is that
any pre-existing condition?
Cross off that.
Any. moment of the pain occurs most, he drinks some cold when his eyes or he touched the tooth or something like that.
And may I just call it back to the first presenting symptom, pain. So you've brought that to that's what's the key.
Characteristic of the pen. With eyes or touching or chewing. So from what I would call from primary principles, so what sort of things do you need to know to be able to understand it? So you've got knowledge up here, but we want to have the steps that got you to that knowledge.
My parents tell me that to be a bacteria, my food and cause of pain.
Just the nerve when the nerve is touched, it causes pain. Sensory nerve, like yesterday. Just when the nerve is touched.
Well, I think our tooth is composed of different parts. It is most of calcium.
Can you draw a tooth?
Yes.
You know that there is the nerve and first of all, the
maybe I just say that. So the intermediate occurs after.
So draw up on that color board and as big as you can.
I draw it very specific.
Yeah. What do you know?
Would it be like this?
I'm not very sure about the pathway. I'm not sure about the vocabulary. It must be some calcium here.
Surface of the teeth and not touch the nerve, it don't care.
am house plant, but we just have to take when the canary is deep enough and touch the nerve of the tooth. For example, the canary is here. So it can cause the toothache.
So you're saying we like the tooth carry as a number one?
And I think so, because it causes intermittent, not continuous. Just intermittent, it means that when something hurts the nerve, like you say, that ice or cold water or food, it causes pain, not continuous.
Hypothesis there. Somebody else go up with their hypothesis if I've got them.
Cứ nói thoải mái à.
What we need is for others to get up.
B, M, L, E.
rather that and ask the group, and then they might say, well, I don't really know, or some will have ideas as to what it is. So that's all right.
So what is the name of this structure?
Structure of the tooth is we cover with the enamel, and then we have dentin, it's mean ngara. And in here we have both, it's the cavity which contain blood vessels and nerve. So when if we have caries, it's mean here. So when we eat something harsh or colorings, the nerve here will be affected immediately. So I will sweep out the caries out. So back to my hypothesis, I think he may have a threat or fracture. A wrecked tooth means that he has just more slide, not the fracture completely, just a more slide on the surface. Yeah. And these caries will affect it mostly when you apply any pressures on it. So it's quite fit with the patients, because when he chews and the pressure increase and he will feel bad. Yeah. So my hypothesis is erected tooth or fracture. About the recent activities. Maybe he may drama or eat something somehow.
He has applied to someone.
Yeah, find someone, eat something somehow, and it's damaged to his teeth. Yes, that's my hypothesis.
Someone can have it how we can teach them, we can teach that the language that we should expand into the more into the near structure, for example, the rules, the teach, and also the verb or the muscle. And the mushroom, the chewing mushroom also.
Okay, let's just bring it back. I'm going to give you some more information, but one question that I think is hanging over, you've talked about pressure, you've talked about ice, you've talked about different things that have been put in our mouth that can impact on this planning. But that is subjective. Do you know what I mean by that? That is what the patient is telling. So what would you want to do as a patient? That physical examination, what would you
swell?
Open that bottle at 38,000 feet, what do you hear?
Hear a And the question in my mind is the mechanism of the pain of the tooth, irritation of the temperature is, or pressure in the two kind of the pain of the tooth. It can come out with the tooth disease.
The cavity may be associated enough and make the pain happen.
Okay, so we've actually said that we haven't got a cavity, but on that diagram, have we got anywhere that could change?
And if my
feelings anywhere up. Change with the lip of front pressure, so this feeling is not cannot tied with the dental, with the dental, through dental.
Okay, that's one thing. What else is up there?
And the patient had a teeth dark. And you know that after the doctor the jam check it that. The cement and remove it, but there is no cavity in there. But after that, he filling it with cement. So I think that because the procedure, he got some echo failure here. Yeah. And when he got up with the ply, with the high ply, and it changed the chain of pressure between inner and outside. So this chain of pressure will cause the pain. So the solution for this case that we have to remove the teeth or fill in completely.
Need it rid out.
Long distance fly and mechanicals test.
Anyone? Which parts of the tooth can feel pain and the pain is stimulated by what factor?
Yes. So that's a question, and you said that beautifully. As a learning issue, you should always be reading as a question. So that would be a question. We're running out of time because everybody's saying to me we have to wind up. But that would be a good question. What do you think you'll come back with when you go away and research that? What aspects of it, the normal anatomy, physiology of what? Sorry. Assessment with the cold and the pressure objectively. So what I'd like to do to you now is I'd like to hand you out the learning objectives. Now these learning objectives written. Now, I'll put them up on the screen. Different. And I always say many learning issues make up a learning objective. So maybe I'll read them rather than objective, in this case, is to describe the basic structure of the tooth, draw it up. We would have different aspects of that tooth drawn up. So you want to go away, you want to hone that learning, you'll go away and learn it yourself. And you'll practice drawing it, you'll rehearse it. When you come back to the report back, the ones who drew it in the first tutorial shouldn't get up, should be the ones who've just gone away and learned it. And they'll rehearse it, they'll practice it. You'll have a questioning, you know, oh, that's not quite right there. In a safe environment. The next one is describe the sensory nerve supply to the face and mouth. So when you go away, looking at what is the conductor of that pain, where is that pain, how is that pain transmitted as a sensation? The other one is, other ones for this particular tutorial are about the PBL process. So as I said, this case is about learning how we do PBL. So the first one is identify and summarising the significant information of the case. The next one is generation of hypotheses, which you've done. Prioritisation of hypotheses. I'm going too fast, please. Logical deduction of information required to distinguish between. Formulation of learning issues. Now, if I was ranking myself on this, I would say we didn't do as well on developing the learning issues because we ran out of time. But I wanted you to get through to the end because you had such depth of knowledge at this table that I wanted you to see the end of the case so that you could work on what you've written up on that board and give some answers to what you were querying about. You all have, everybody in this room was ignited by what we were doing. So, is there any questions? Like, I don't know whether the lady over there queried about having the learning objectives first, whether that would have helped.
Actually, I don't need to, like, have a list because I think you were wondering
about
how to guide that discussion along.
Well, the case that we're going to later on, that I will actually give a tutor briefing as to where it fit to do. So I have a piece of paper and I have who sits where in my group. I put a name and I put your background on there so that if there are any issues, I can actually say, well, do you think, because you're a pathologist, you might be able to question the group based upon your knowledge about this condition. Or if we get really stuck, I can say, well, could you explain it so that we can get moving? Now, I was also asked by Anne whether we could use our phone to Google to work out what's happening. That's okay if you get totally stuck and it's important, you as a tutor know it's important to get over that. You can do that. But my research in my PhD is looking at how students are not learning because they are using that too quickly. So, thank you again. Sorry, I don't have morning tea.
Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Hold it really close and I'll try not to scare. first tutorial, and I really wanted to encourage you all, and I felt that there were challenges in that first tutorial for you all. One of the challenges was that you were being first year students and you're not. And another challenge was you were working in your second language, so sometimes what I said was not clear. And then there was a conversation going on around the group about what did she say, what, so it was a challenging situation. Even so, I was absolutely delighted with how well my group worked as a group and really engaged and trusted the process and went with me and got good diagrams on the board, good writing on the board. We had a progress from an initial little diagram we weren't quite sure to a really wonderful diagram, a beautiful tooth that had the enamel.
What's wrong with it?
Okay, you can go and do it now. No, not really. Okay, so we'll talk about the PBLT's role. Okay, what the tutor looks like. You can see in that picture, can you come back and you've done a report back and you've been telling each other, I found this and I found that, oh, I found that. Do people understand the word congruent? It means fits in, okay? There is an ease. They are not superior, they are with the group, okay? It's more even, okay? Yeah. That is to create. Not to me all the time. And I had to watch out the corner of my eye when I looked away at someone else to direct the conversation to the group, in case you were discouraged. So then I look back at you, just to keep going, and then I look back over, talk to your friends, okay? So managing the group behavior all the time. Do not worry that you need to be an expert in this to begin as a PBL tutor, okay? I have been doing it for 30 years, so I have an ease about it. But I didn't at the beginning. Jill and I were sharing notes, both of us were so nervous in our first tutorial. And we both sat there going, I'll just wait and see what happens. We were lucky because our groups were already established. Yeah. Okay, so those are the things you're watching. So you can imagine if you're watching those three things that's going on in the group, you get quite busy inside your mind. You're thinking a lot. So, just to remind you, in case, you know, we're doing the activities, key information, hypotheses. Why do you think that's so? Okay. What else could it be? You would have heard both Jill and I asking those sorts of questions. Tell me about that. What is the mechanism? You know, so we had infection, we had inflammation, we had expansion and compression and oppression and, you know, sensitivity and a whole lot of stuff. And we really worked that hard. You would have noticed that the first page of the hardest, and then the new information just helps refine things. And we got to our learning issues. Initially, the learning issues were, I said to you, what do you think you need to know now? What are you curious to go away and learn? And so we wrote up anatomy, etc. And then we said, well, okay, that's fine, what's your question? When you open your anatomy book, what are you going to be looking for? So we refine the learning issue question. And of course now, the book read up on teeth. And
the particular case is in the present, and what associated sessions are with it, such as lectures, clinical skills, they might have anatomy, physiology, in this case, to Vietnam. It is similar, everything is similar, disappears. Has to go up on the board so that you can all see what's happening. And what's happening, because when you read it yourself, you...
The way we're going to do this is that each tutor will be different people, yes, keep an eye on the content, but as a PBL tutor, let's keep an eye on the process, always thinking what the next process step is. And so we might find that students are identifying the key information and some are racing ahead. They want to make the diagnosis, and the tutor's role will be bring it back and say, Well, let's think about what might be happening here. What's happening here? What are your hypotheses? And then the next tutor, it might be around, so what explains that? You might point to the student who said a hypothesis and say, can you explain why you thought that was the case? So as we go, we'll change tutors over, we'll pull out the room, we'll talk about what's to happen next, and then the next person gets to go. Now, that makes it a bit of an interrupted process, okay? So the experience you had this morning as students, there was a flow, okay? There was a flow to the process. This will be interrupted. So there are some challenges to that interrupted process. We've thought long and hard how to change that, but we feel it's necessary to keep everyone going. Sometimes when the tutors are outside of the room, learning how, you know, talking about it and choosing who's next and who's going to have the next go, the students get on with the QBL case. So sometimes we go into the room and they've already moved on. So sometimes the tutor has to bring the action back to the key steps of the PBL process. So that's what's going to happen. Jill will take one group, I will take the other group. Jill and I are still a little bit worried that there's such big numbers that it might be quite disruptive having everyone pulling out of the room every time. So there may be some people who don't want to have a go at being a tutor and they might choose to sit in the back more as an observer. I think if you're going to be one of the PBL tutor trainers, you should absolutely be in that first group. It may be that we can only pull the first row group out. And I think that might be how we have to go, in which case it will be really interesting for those of you who sit quietly around the wall to keep watching the students and what they're doing. They may do some interesting things when the tutor is out of the room, okay? And that will be something that we can talk about later. Does anyone have any questions about that process? I hope you're happy to just let it unfold and we will guide you. So in the meantime, Jill's briefing the students. You have your tutor notes. Familiarise yourself with, just look at how it's set out and see that on each page there are guides for the tutor. So you have the abstract, which the tutor students will have. You have the learning objectives. I often keep the learning objectives in front of me. That's what guides what I push on, that I question. And then you'll see that there are the screens the students get, and then there's some process hints underneath. You'll see on that first one, it's giving you some hints about what you might do as a tutor, okay? And then on the next one, further down, it's got tutor notes. You'll notice that there's this title there called, this is on page 5, prompting questions. The case writer always puts some prompting questions there because the case writer is anticipating the sorts of questions you might ask.
A little bit further on, we just want to brainstorm ideas. What's happening? What could potentially be happening? Anything? Thank you. So you, have you got your case? One thing I forgot to do.
Yes.
So you need to get them to introduce themselves.
Alright.
Yeah. So we just go around the room. And as I said before, as a tutor, I usually have a note as to what each is their background. Now I know, notice from my little introduction to them there, they are either first year preclinical, second or third year preclinical. So we've got a mixture. So they will tell you whereabouts they are. And as a tutor, you will know approximately what sort of information they will have associated with that. But I've told them that they all have important information to bring when they brainstorm. So please don't be shy. Is that all right? Okay, so shall I go and get them?
If you can tell a little bit about the introduction, like how far they introduce?
I just say, welcome to the... Yeah, and just could each student just introduce themselves by their name and what level of education they're at, what's their, where they are, whether first, second or third. And then, you know, they might want to say a little bit about themselves. But we're going to have to be pretty tight in this, so I'll most probably just keep it to, you know, their name and what level they're at. Normally you'd ask them before.
Do I need to tell them about books?
Yeah? No. You can say to them, now we're going to have a case presented. We're going to have key, and as they, and you start them off, you can actually say to them, this is why I like having the board drawn up and have key information, hypotheses, and further information drawn up, and a little need to know box. So I usually get them to organise it because this is a brand new group, you've never done PBR, and so you're going to have to teach them how to do it. I'm here. and I am here. Yeah. Like, you can look at me and say, help. And I will help. Okay? So none of you need to fear, because it is such, when you're sitting there, it's a hard job.
Second year student,
write down the information your brain find out. Who is volunteer?
The one is.
A lady first or man first? Okay, lady first.
Yeah.
People. Okay, pretty good. You can use the color pen over there. Now you can start. Look at the screen and you tell me what you see and what kind of information you get from this screen. Yeah, you can tell.
Seems very perceptive that you guys was able to pinpoint the gentleman as being a farmer, but that speculation seems far-fetched because the picture is close up.
Mm-hmm.
It's hard to determine if he's a farmer. I think that what we can know from this gentleman is that he's for sure is in middle age. We know his name. He's male, for sure he's Vietnamese, but as to whether he is a farmer, his profession, it's really unsure at the moment because it's close up and we can't assume anything from, it's a picture, right? So we need more information, I think.
Okay, we can move to the next slide, please.
General symptoms that we can easily catch up with any
Yes, hypothesis. Please separate the table.
Do you want me to help?
Okay.
Can I just help you?
Yes. In related to.
Because we need more information.
Yeah, but yeah, so that's what
we're asking.
ask for more information. We have all right.
Just say out my prediction.
Right, right. Because it's, you're in the second year, so it's understandable that that's what you've done. Right. So on our side, as my peers and I have pushed you, then we would ask the reason as to what are the three reasons that correlates that would have to make an impact that the doctor has to refer to a hospital. Makes sense, right? So, because we're taking one step at a time, because we're
pursuing. I think that would be quite a clear and we need more information about this.
Right.
Now we don't need to give the hypothesis now.
Yeah, we don't need the hypothesis right now because. The hypothesis right now is just basically we are pinpointing that we're just making questions like why? But I'm asking for the reason. I'm looking at
you. Can you give the question? What is night sweat?
Yeah, what is night sweat? I don't know what is night sweat.
Okay,
please define that, right? I don't know. What's fever? How is it? I get fever all the time. So how is that important? Right? So I know that there are certain fevers. What contribute to fever that makes me want to, let's say, go to see a physician, right?
Yeah, no, I get it.
Yeah, exactly. Because the we're pushed to the point where we can't.
Yeah, I know.
Right?
I understand.
It was a pressure, right? So
yeah.
Let's just relax.
I know, because the tutor asked me, what is the mechanism?
What you wrote there, I'm trying to correlate with what I could understand.
Yeah.
So it means that it's something that I need to research on more. Right?
Yeah. Okay, I get it.
But what
did you sponsor?
It's like,
we did
you
want
to
make a video?
We
taught you. Really? Oh my god! But you do
not. So, it's 51 years old man, is he a middle age?
Yeah.
Is that considered to be a middle age?
Yeah.
I think Warhorse is
here. No, I'm just wondering. Is 51 years old considered
Yeah.
middle age?
Yeah.
So, if he's 51 years old, there's other symptoms to it. He's a farmer, right? So, which means, could he be healthy or? Unhealthy.
He worked hard,
right?
Yes.
So he's 51 years old, he's a farmer, he works hard. So he has fever, night sweat, and cough. So night sweat, what exactly is night sweat?
Sweat at night.
So, I mean, like, is he hot? I mean, like, is he hot, right? So at night he slept and it's hot, so that's why he has to go to the hospital or what? So, what
it's
exactly?
How
severe is the cough? Because if the cough is severe to the point where he has to be admitted to the hospital, there has to be something really severe. I don't know what type
of cough. So we need to ask for more information.
Yeah, exactly. So I mean, like normal cough, or what type of cough is it?
Yes, yes.
You know what
I
mean?
Thank you.
discuss about the mechanism, you know, mechanism, why the patient has fever, nice pain, and cough. Do you have something to want to explain more about the symptoms of the patient?
As we discussed, we at this moment, at this time, we don't need to discuss more about the mechanism of this. So we think that we should find out more about the patient's information. Like, we're still wondering about how severe the cough is and how severe the fever is.
Yeah. Yes. So we're going to have more information about the fever of the patient and
and also we don't know what night sweats are.
We don't know night sweats. You know, night is the evening, you know, already.
Yeah.
Yeah. But sweat, when you do something, you have, if you have sweating, your skin becomes sweat. You know?
Oh, so it just means that you sweat at night?
But
we want to know if is that the sweat caused by the weather or just because of his body is sick, so he sweats.
Do you think that is because of weather or because of the disease
application? By the disease, I think that anything is possible.
Yeah, anything is possible. I think that thing is, do you think that thing is the climate of the land of the
Asian? In Vietnam, it's Vietnamese.
In Vietnam, so always up, even in the land.
Yes, so that is more confused.
It is just because of the weather, then I don't think it's something severe enough to be brought to the hospital. I think in this case, night sweats must be something related to the disease, so that the general practitioner brings him to the hospital.
So, yeah.
Right, so basically what we want to know is this, because we've understood that the gentleman is a 51 years old farmer. He is a middle-aged man. Farmer, being he's working hard, we have three symptoms, I guess, fever, night sweat, and cough. But what's significant about these three symptoms? What correlates them that makes it important that the general practitioner has to refer to the hospital? Because if someone to refer to a hospital, it means that the person has to be severe, right? In a general case, the practitioner would be able to solve it at his or her clinic, right? So what we want to know is that exactly these three basic symptoms, what gives it?
So we're not going to give you more information yet.
Sorry to interrupt. But there are other mechanisms up here. You discussed fever. What other things has he got there that you might know a little bit about?
To the point where this man has to be admitted to the hospital, right?
So I'm guessing how severe is the cough?
How severe are the symptoms?
I mean like it's mad, right? We cough, right? So how frequently does it cough? How heavy is it cough? Does it interrupt his daily life or something like that, right? I mean, fever and cough, that's for sure.
So, you can propose the hypothesis of the disease, and you think something caused cough and then in fever, so you can suggest the hypothesis.
From these three points, fever, night sweat, and cough.
And give the information, the important information. This is the main reason why the general practitioner give Mr. Star to the hospital. Yes, it's very important because with the fever, night sweat and cough, you don't need to go to the hospital.
Exactly.
Yes, if he show here.
Yeah, then it has to be severe. So which one is more severe?
We need to
put it. Right, so we should, let's rearrange it, right?
Yes, I mean, I'm not sure what teacher wants. I think the tutor wants us to do what we're doing.
Yeah.
Because she did more than you remember. She was just asking us, what else do you know about? What else?
Yeah, because what else do we know?
Yeah,
because
we talked to her.
Yeah, but the thing that you're saying, that we will discuss is, but
not what she wants
later on.
Yeah.
Not this moment. And this moment, I believe that we have to get the hypothesis.
Okay.
How we help them.
So, can you guys think of one?
I'll give a question and we
what?
And see will be
us more.
So,
and we will eliminate those hypotheses.
Okay, sure. Then someone have a go then. First question.
Do you remember that we've been asking for more information?
Right, so
she,
you give the first
yeah,
think of one and have a piece, sir. So let's give one.
I don't believe the hypothesis, but with this slide, I will have a short question. First question is the main reason did he go to the hospital. The second reason is the severe of the fever,
right.
And the severe of cough.
Right. So
yes,
this
is three questions.
Yeah. Which one is the main reason? I think that until we get more information, we can really decide. Because herniate degrees fever is not that.
So that will be for the information.
Yeah, you can never get far out. But I think probably so I was saying they don't agree. Nhưng mà nếu mà bệnh nhân khó khăn hơn rồi thì số 4 thì cũng sẽ dịch đó cái lý thì mình sao?
Because I see on your the first hypothesis, that is infection. So infection, can you explain me what is the ADVM definition of infection?
That is a strange substance that comes in our body.
Yeah.
And bacteria. Infection is related to bacteria. Infection.
Microorganisms.
Yeah.
So it's why good answers. But how can you link between fever, night west, and cough?
So basically, you want us to think what lead to. So basically, could be coughing. You could have a fever, right? The night before that, he was admitted to the hospital. He could have a fever. And that fever could lead to night sweat, which may be intertwined with a coughing, that, you know, coughing, severe coughing or something like that, severe fever would interrupt his daily life or normal.
For more information, Right. This case is what you find included in reality. So this patient who came to you and you say that, yeah, I have symptoms. And now think more about the system. Think more about the system of the body. So infection may be a rot, yeah, protein. This can affect any part of the body. So with the symptom, you need to combinations and analyze. So do you think, yeah?
Might have some kind of pulmonary disease.
Yeah, that's good. Did you write up?
Can you repeat it? Yeah.
understand the Bible, that how can do you have anything to hide?
I want to know if any member of his family have any pulmonary disease.
You don't think you've got much knowledge, but you actually are demonstrating a lot of knowledge. So there is no right or wrong here. You are brainstorming. You're coming up with great ideas. Please don't put yourself down and say you don't have enough knowledge, because what this is a safe environment. So you can put forward your ideas, not quite knowing all the background. So don't put yourself down.
Yeah, I think you should add something
else. I would like to know more about his whereabouts recently, because there might be a possibility that he has gone to an academic area.
Then we're going to move out for another little bit. Okay, let's go.
Yeah, if we keep talking about all different kinds of disease, you know, I mean, asthma, COPD, HIV, it's full of hypotheses,
yes.
But not in that sense, because, like, you know nothing about
there
it.
There is no sense. Actually, I think this is like, I think that this, the class is like the first stage that you get a lot of reasoning. Then the second stage, we will give more information, and then we will eliminate those hypotheses. And then that's when we get closer to the final. So at
okay,
this stage,
it's just saying,
yeah,
it is not
yeah.
Right, it will be eliminated at
yes,
this stage.
Yes,
oh,
it
so
is right.
One of the hypotheses we have is that fever, sweats, and heart.
Any other comments? Yes.
Okay, so I need to sit down now.
Yeah, because that means that you're the boss.
Ah, yeah, I see.
We want to be socially in their group. We really do. We want to be part of their group. So the next person who sits in there might want to sit closer, move up one chair, sit closer to them. And that, all that means is that, you know, you're part of it, because they're actually all looking. All the tutors so far, they've been looking at you. And what we want them, what you to do now is, when they look at you, you can one of the others, you look away or down or have a drink, like I said, I do, I drink lots of it. But deflect it to them. And if they don't respond, you say, well, what does the group mean? So let's start it as a, what's the group? Because I think they're warming up now. I think you've done, the first three have broken the ice. They're starting to warm up. So who would like to go next?
Next one.
Next tutor. Pick
volunteer, please.
Mine.
Yes.
Okay. So the three things we know should list up here what we think that. So basically, it was from the three main symptoms. Then we can see clearly that what exactly that is. We can
say what do we think is the hypothesis. We will know why our hypothesis is wrong. So in the future, we don't make the same mistake again. So I don't think there's anything wrong with saying a lot of hypothesis.
Yeah, just, we just organize them. Basically, we have a lot of mumbo jumbo on there that we don't know what is most important. Is that right? You guys agree, right?
Yeah.
So let's, we should organize it now.
Organize it?
Yeah, organize it. What is priority?
So I think you should do it because organizing things, you have to, here's a line. Maybe you can
just go
and
that's
good. Since you have already transferred to the hospital because of fever, night sweat, and cough. We have been asking about why the patient has been transferred to the hospital. I think you can imagine that when you are in a night, you are in your night shift, and you got a call from a nurse that you have a person with just that information on the way from your room, so we'll see the patient, you can have something in your mind why the patient is transferred to you, what's might be wrong with him, and you think of every condition that you think the patient might get, so it's not very important at this point. So for the hypothesis, I can say a lot of things. I want to pulmonary disease, pulmonary disease is kind of wrong. Could you tell me what might be the disease, what kind of disease that the patient can get?
COPD. She says
pulmonary disease
is a legal problem. So we want to make it more specific. So I see that previously you did mention COPD or asthma, so I think she wanted us to put it on the board too.
You're talking about COPD, what is it?
We're talking about a possibility.
Yes.
That can happen to a patient.
COPD is, what is the name of the disease? Can you just say it with full name?
Obstructive.
Anyone can help him?
Whether
how the weather changes, we catch some organism, but the food is different because many different organism germs can cause infection. Can you tell me some of those classes?
Virus,
viral disease, viral infection, anything else?
Bacterial, fungus.
How a patient can get a fungus disease?
I think it was his environment. His environment. He's a farmer, so he worked on the farm. It's very easy. It's more strict to be fungus.
Any other?
We discussed earlier that for the infection part, for bacteria or toxin that we were discussing earlier, could it be that fertilizer or something like that can be used or they exposed to some kind of chemical, exposed to toxin over there that would cause them to get severe cough or fever and sweat? Basically, it's just bacterial infection from environmental issues.
So it can be the bacterial, viral, other things?
Chemical.
Okay.
I think chemical is, can be grouped into this exposure to toxic gas. So apart from those, from the infection, chemical, toxin, any other conditions can cause cough and fever. Weather. Because of the weather. More than cough and flu.
Weather changing. On these symptoms, on the disease, can you think cause cough and fever in a patient? So how this disease cause fever? How can they cause a fever in a patient? Do you know? Bacterial infection, they cause a fever. How?
I think fever is like a reaction of your body, of the immune system of your body to protect yourself from the attack of strange substance, such as bacteria, for example.
Yes, but how the temperature go up?
Do you remember who said this? I forget. I'm sorry that I don't remember correctly. I'm sorry.
Okay, so we have a look at it. This part later. So you have many hypotheses. For those hypotheses, I wanted to group them into some group, and then what will be the most likely disease that you think? We will rank them from top to bottom, okay? So
can I just say they had a point that they didn't know the fever anymore. So that might be a need to know. In the box there, so they might want to put, they've exhausted their mechanism of fever, so they might want to put that in that little box. But you're going on beautifully, so you can stay this.
About the mechanism of fever, we will have to have a look at this matter later.
The students, right?
So, can anyone help me to group those hypotheses?
Excuse me, but I have a question here that since we have a fever mechanism here in the need to know box, then why don't we have a cough mechanism and
adaptation, the mechanism of coughing, and night sweating. Night sweat, I saw already, so about the cough. What can cause coughing in a patient? Do you know it or not?
I think the tension invades your respiratory system. This is very normal reactions that you have to use the force to force to excrete the pathogen outside. So it's like coughing is the process of excrete the pathogen from your lungs or your bronchus to outside.
What about allergy?
Well, allergy, I think. What is allergy? I think allergy is something referred to
first do the cough.
Oh, to avoid that cough first.
Yeah, you're doing the cough, which is really good. Talk about.
This is your respiratory system. So when the one of the most easiest way to get into your body is through your nose or your mouth. We already know this always leads to the respiratory system. So when the pathogen get inside, so this is some it's from the outside, so your body is not accepted. You have to put it out. So they have the mechanism of coughing is that your bronchus or your pneumocystis, then they will constrict. Yeah, they will constrict to excrete the pathogen outside and keep your body to maintain your body. Do you understand what I'm trying to explain?
I think the teacher is asking us how allergy causes coughing.
That's okay. He's drawing up a nice diagram. You can apply it to yourself. About allergy.
Okay, about allergy.
On the diagram. On the same diagram.
Well, I don't know exactly what's the link between allergy and the cough, because I think allergy is much more referred to your immune system. So, yes.
So, well, I think that's good enough for some parts of what causes the cough in a patient. For the other parts, the allergy parts, and other causes that can stimulate the cough, we can look it up later when with the help of some textbook, okay?
Yeah.
About the help of physics. Someone help me to what is the most likely disease that you think?
Personally, I think the tuberculosis is the most possible one because it's severe enough to transfer him into the hospital by his general practitioner.
I think it's infection.
So infection and tuberculosis is some kind of infection. Do you agree? So what's different if from other kind of infection?
I think it's the cause.
The cause. Do you know what caused tuberculosis?
I believe that tuberculosis is caused by an Mycobacterium tuberculosis infection.
We're all going to go out, but I want you to continue on putting up what you think.
It's like a chemical.
No, cancer or something.
Oh, cancer.
Cancer throat.
Yeah. No. What did you think of?
Bits of information do you have about that? Can anybody else answer that? Now, I've told them that you're not to answer all questions, so you're not there for that. They have to do that. That's what I just reminded them of there. If they can't get to the answer or the information that they want, it goes in that box. And at the end, we might say, oh yes, we did find that out as we were talking. No, we didn't find that one out. We want to go away and find that. And so the next person who goes in will be, and I think we most probably should move on a little bit. So I think we can go on and to the next page. But maybe at the further information, say what is the, after they've ranked their hypotheses.
Maybe should I ask them some question? Like I extract the information of the case and ask them about the question, like they need more symptoms about this information. More symptom. This is a question that will be answered in the next slide.
So what is the
move on next slide?
So when they've given what they think is the most possible, one, two, three of their hypotheses, you can ask, well, what information are you looking for to help you work out whether it's number one? And you've already got there in the key information. We won't go through two and three because that might be too much, but they have got those that information there. And sometimes students put lines to it to say what's linked to it. I always say to students, you should not put anything up there. That you, nothing should be put up on the board unless it's explained and it's got some other information to support it being up there. So that's what I think would be the next task, and then we can go on. Now, I actually am timing, sorry, because I'm losing my time going. So I've been giving you 10 minutes so that I can hopefully get through everyone.
10 minutes of breakfast.
Thank you.
Second.
Get up and put number one where you think is the most.
Okay, number one.
She can choose infectious. But if you ask
if she is infectious, whether she will choose common flu or tuberculosis, she can't make that choice based on her current knowledge yet. Yeah, so she thinks this is an infectious disease, but she don't have any priorities.
We might move out first and then we'll come to you. Thank you. And I'm sorry if I meant to. Group doesn't. And the scribe up the front saying, well, what do you want? What do you want up here? What's the questions that you want? Come on, give it to me. And so,
like,
so is that.
Should we have a team leader who is a student? They control the discussion. Can we just do like a tutor? We interfere when we need. Like we feel they go so far, and so we make them follow the directions.
Yeah. That's one way of getting them to do it if they're not working. But I think in this case, this is an extreme case of you going in and doing it. The students here have got that information, but they are still looking at you because there's lots of you were talking lots to them to start off with, and you were looking at them, and you're going. Responding. So anybody else got anything else to say? Because I felt that there was one thing that you did was that you started to look towards them to get them to do it, and then they started to
to join in. We've got a valid suggestion that I think we should bring up later, but I think in here at the moment, the tutor is the person, not necessarily directing it, but we are kind of conducting them. We're trying to give them permission to all give their own voice in there. I don't want one person dominating in there, because if you do, you'll only get one person dominating the whole time and the others will be less likely. You're more one step removed from them to be able to do that. But I'm open to that. So, anything else anybody wanted to say?
I could see when the green room, when the pinball information is enough, is it about paragraph information to influence here?
Yes. Now we're going to, the next person who's going to go on will go back in and put that slide up. I'm really sorry I lent to them. And they've most probably seen it now. Did you see what I did? I lent on it and the next slide came up.
Ah, okay. What is it?
So
actually I saw her dilemma. I think she's trying to direct the group towards some certain information, and she's trying very hard to get it. So I wonder, you know, as tutor, you have how much you should stick to the objective, learning objectives. Sort of, they don't, you don't get it.
Yeah.
Okay, move on.
Yeah.
How much you let them go free, like the COPD thing. It's extra information. It's good, but it's not in the learning objective, so it's not being tracked. Because you also have to finish the case a certain amount of time.
That's right. In a real case, you most probably would do that. But I like it in here because it really challenges you and it puts you on that spot. So I think that despite the fact of going off on a tangent, it really does give you how am I going to get them back? Because the students will do that, and you have to be able to get them back. Now they've put it on their need to know. At the end, when whoever's going to tidy it up, we'll say, well, is that going? Are we going to need to look at that today? Let's refine and define the learning issue. But I thought that you did a great job. Maybe talked a little bit too much to them, and that's, I think, is most probably where you want to have somebody else do that, because you felt responsible. And I know that feeling. You do feel responsible for them, and it is hard. And if that's the way that it works for you to delegate somebody else to do that, I don't have a problem. But I think at the moment, all of these things are really important to be able to experiment with in this safe environment as a tutor, and look at yourself and look at others and work out what works and what doesn't work. So I think you did a brilliant job. I like the fact that you went off on another tangent with them, because that means that they now have to rationalise that. And in their logic, they're going to have to say, well, I don't think we need that. And we have to give them permission to say, I don't think we need that. My concern is when we went in last time, they had erased things off the board. Now, erasing things means we lose the track of where we've been. And the students, have you noticed, aren't writing things down. They're all collaborating on the board. So they've lost that track. And that's an unfortunate thing. That was nobody's fault. I should have said to them at the beginning, don't erase it. But that's something that maybe we can reinforce whoever goes in next time. And let's keep everything up on the board at the moment. You wanted to say something when we were in there?
First, as the students say, that they have a lot of things to hold. And since she doesn't hold that there is something to need to know.
Mm.
Yes. And moreover, when the students, she says that she don't know areas, materials accepting the tuberculosis. I think you should say that they can say you can classify them in other materials and put them down in the little knowledge.
Yes. So that can be a bullet, a point in there.
Yes.
But that basket does get big.
Yes.
But as I said at the end, we tailor it. And that's where we know where the objectives are. And if they do go so wide, in some cases, I've actually, if I cannot get them back, I let them go. And they come back and report back and they said, oh, what did I do that for? Why did we say that? And never do it again. And then they don't rely on the tutor as much. They start doing it themselves. So they learn, sometimes the hard way, and they won't do it again. And it's safe to do it in this, safe in this environment. Because don't forget, we've got all these other sessions around us, all these other sessions. So they will get that information, and they will, in the end, get the right amount of information. So, but it is okay in the early years of doing it to let them make these mistakes. Who's going next? I don't know who's in the pink.
I can go next
to the one.
Yeah. But I have the advantage of, you know, my language really is very good, so I don't have to go.
Yeah, I know, it's very difficult. So, it was actually the ones with the pink have to go first, if that's all right.
Venus of pink.
Okay. I'm sorry, the pink.
Venus of pink.
Is that okay? If you're more comfortable in speaking to them in Vietnamese, do it. Because it's not... They speak English really well, all of them. So if you're more comfortable, that's okay. I will just cope. Okay?
Okay.
Presented illness. Mr. Nguyen had a worsening productive cough for the past 3 months. The sputum is yellow and occasionally blood stained. He is a heavy smoker and therefore has always had a productive cough. He has had increasing pain and on coughing, but no shortness of breath. He thinks he has lost weight because his clothes feel loose on him. Mr. Nguyen currently lives on his farm with his family. His wife died 2 years ago. He thinks she died of a respiratory infection. He relies on family for his meals and often eats poorly. Alcohol intake is uncertain.
Can you call the pay information? Would you call the pay information in this case? Worsening productive car for 3 months. What is? Student yellow. Let's see.
Thank you.
So.
But the strange thing about what I think is because this buttock is yellow, and according to what I know up to now, is the reason of the yellow buttock is because of infection. So lung cancer is not infection. Actually, now you can put the color of spectrum, the color of fluids can actually can address to the least yellow.
Yeah, it's here.
Need to know if
it's so. Is anyone a member of the group was downloaded the fluid of the can list Jewish in the list to know to discuss information so the next day.
Yeah. Actually, I don't agree with this people because I think cancer can be a chance to that person to get infected.
Oh, nice.
They can be cancer and he can be infected too. So I think we should keep the cancer. And I don't know whether I don't know whether the fibroid lung is kind of a disease or not because I think this can be a possibility of the fibroid lung because he smoked. So this can be
so that
a possibility.
I think cancer might cause the weakening of his immune system. So that's how
We might just go on to the next couple of slides because we've got to finish up soon and have some learning issues. So is that alright if we just go through to our next slide? Is that alright?
Can you write the fibroid lung on the
cancer? Or lymphadenopathy. About the chest.